A vacation. A stirring on the other half of the bed woke Nick up, and he lay there for a moment, eyes closed, enjoying the motion of the bed as it rocked slightly with someone's sleeping breath. As he woke up, a question popped into his mind: who, exactly, was lying next to him? The day before was still a bit fuzzy, but he couldn't remember meeting a girl, let alone inviting one to spend the night with him. How could he have invited a girl to sleep with him here in the beach house, with his parents and aunt and uncle just down the hallway? Opening his eyes, he looked over with a bit of trepidation. It was his little cousin, Mike, lying on his stomach fast asleep. Lying far too away for this to be the cot in the room Nick had claimed. Looking around the room, this appeared to be one of the three main bedrooms, presumably the one Mike had been sleeping in. Nick sat up and looked around more carefully. There was plenty of light, thanks not only to the bits slipping past the edge of the window shades, but to the nightlight which still glowed across the room. Nick had, apparently, shared the queen-sized bed not only with Mike, but with the giraffe he recognized as Mike's personal companion and a lion which was less familiar. But why? He tried to remember the day before. It was easy enough to remember the long drive from home, in the back seat, headphones on, practically sulking about his parents' theft of a week of his precious summer vacation for a family trip to the middle of nowhere. He remembered gleefully claiming the little room at the end of the hallway, the one with the fold-out cot, gladly accepting the mediocre bed for a shred of privacy. He had, even, fantasized a bit about meeting a fellow college student, perhaps, like him, stranded here with family, and sneaking her in through the back door. The thought made Nick glance over at his companion. The boy was sprawled out in just his underwear, the lack of pajamas presumably a concession to the heat. Looking down, Nick wasn't surprised to see that he, too, had slept in just underwear. He was surprised that, instead of his usual boxers, he was wearing flyless blue striped briefs. Indeed, they appeared to be identical to the ones Mike was wearing. A bit embarrassed, not to mention confused, by the skimpy clothes, Nick decided to head over to his actual room to change. Trying not to wake Mike, he shifted carefully to the edge of the bed and stepped off. Well, in fact, fell off. For some reason, his feet didn't reach the floor, so instead of standing, he ended up landing with a thump, losing his balance and falling against the bed, shaking it a bit. The combination of noise and movement, naturally, woke Mike, who yawned loudly and stretched. The strange fall off the bed triggered memories of the day before. The odd lightheadedness he'd started to feel after the big fight with his parents. The strange, secretive grin Mike had kept delivering Nick all evening. But more than that, he remembered thinking it was unusual for the bathroom mirror to be so high that he could barely see in it. And after the family had all gathered round to watch some Pixar cartoon, had Nick really fallen asleep during it? He could remember feeling sleepy, and couldn't seem to remember even going to bed after. Mike snapped him out of his attempts to piece the previous day together. "Mornin', Nick," the boy slurred, half opening his eyes. "Good morning, Mike." "I'm just going to go get dressed," Nick said, creeping towards the door. "Okay." The boy trailed off, sounding confused. Nick tiptoed down the hallway, not really wanting to be seen almost naked by the rest of his family. The snoring coming from his parents' room suggested they were asleep, and the lack of noise or movement from the common room made it likely his aunt and uncle were as well. He made it to the end of the hall, opened the door, and found the room completely empty. His suitcase and his backpack were both gone. The laptop that had been sitting on the desk, the iPod, wallet, and keys he'd left on the dresser, all gone. Nick returned down the hallway, just as stealthily. Mike was sitting on the bed working on some sort of puzzle book. "Hey, Mike, do you have any idea where my suitcase might be?" Mike looked at him like it was the stupidest question in the world and pointed to a corner of the room. There was a suitcase there, a small one Nick vaguely recognized as belonging to his parents. Not sure why it was in this room, or why Mike thought it was his, Nick went over. It did have clothes in it, an odd mix, and certainly not his, but holding them up, they did seem the right size. Finding some comparatively normal ones, jean shorts and a sleeveless red shirt, he pulled them on, willing to prioritize his modesty. Mike was 8, an age when modesty was a less definitive thing, and seemed to have no such concern. "Are the grown-ups up?" Nick flinched slightly, annoyed that the young boy didn't consider Nick old enough to be a grown-up. "No, I think they're all still asleep." "Okay." Mike seemed mostly unconcerned. "Wanna help me with this puzzle?" Nick sighed. Really, he wanted his parents to wake up so he could get some clue what was going on and get his stuff back, so he'd have something to do, but waking them up early would make that ever so much harder, so he'd just have to kill time until then. "Sure, whatever." Nick climbed onto the bed, struck again by just how oddly tall it was, and kneeled next to Mike to look at the puzzle. In fact, despite its presence in a book aimed for kids Mike's age, it was quite complicated, and it took even the two of them together some time to work it out. Nick, who'd never been a big fan of puzzles of that sort, indeed, as his grades attested, of thinking too hard for any reason, found the process frustrating and tedious, and suggested more than once that they look at the solution in the back of the book, at least enough to get a hint. When the puzzle was finally solved, Mike was eager to move on to the next one, but Nick had had enough. "You can do the next puzzle. I'm going for a walk. Even this little town must have somewhere for people his age to hang out, and while it probably wouldn't be open yet, if he could find it he'd have somewhere to justify running off to later." Nick hopped off the bed, more deftly this time, and headed for the door. "You can't go out. The grown-ups aren't up yet." Nick rolled his eyes. "I'm allowed to go out if I want." "No. The grown-ups have to sup ER vice. That's what they said." "No, Mike, they have to supervise if you go out." "Nah." Nick ignored him and started walking down the hallway. From behind, he heard Mike call, "I'm telling," and the sound of Mike knocking on one of the closed doors, but he kept on walking, content to let Mike get in trouble. He was almost out the front door when footsteps charged down the hallway and a hand firmly gripped his shoulder. "Nicholas Daniel Piper, what do you think you're doing?" Turning, Nick looked up at his father. "Way up." His father, who should have been a few inches shorter than Nick, instead towered over him. In the back of his mind, it occurred to Nick that a lot of things had been suspiciously tall, but he'd somehow kept overlooking the significance. Still, he tried to answer the question confidently. I'm taking a walk." Despite his best efforts, it came out less like a confident assertion, and more like an unsteady, almost defiant, question. "Not without supervision, you're not. You know the rules, Nick. You can't go out of the house without a grown-up. You're not old enough." The absurdity: he was old enough to go to college, but not to take a walk into town, combined with Nick's building frustration at the whole vacation, burst out. I'm old enough to go out by myself." Once again, when the words actually came out, they didn't sound quite the way Nick had intended: less self-assurance, more whining, and far too petulant. Worse, they set his father off into a lengthy rant about Nick's behavior. Nick was used to these. Of course, he could almost make a mad lib for one, mixing in the key phrases that always appeared: "I don't know what's gotten into you," and a few criticisms adjusted to the occasion: "You could have gotten hurt, that was very dangerous." Perhaps it was the same pent-up frustration, but this one bothered Nick. A lot embarrassingly, he felt his eyes fill up with tears. He tried to hang on to his usual self-control, or at least keep in mind that he had to figure out why he seemed to be so much smaller, but the tide of emotion swept it all away, until he was sobbing openly, unable to think about anything but the combination of anger and shame he was feeling. When his father grabbed him roughly by the arm and dragged him down the hallway, it only upset him further, and he found himself shoved into the corner of the room that was supposed to be his bedroom, and ordered to stay there and think about his behavior. It took several minutes for him to get control of the sobbing. He considered sneaking away, but fear of another lecture from his father kept him in place, sniffling quietly, for what felt like an eternity. Finally, he heard footsteps, and then his mother's voice. "All right, Nicky, I think you've been there long enough. Do you think you can behave now?" Eager, desperate to get out of there, he turned and nodded eagerly. She knelt down with a tissue and wiped his eyes and nose dry, and he followed her to the kitchen, where the rest of the family was sitting down for breakfast. Legs dangling wildly, barely able to see over the edge of the table, Nick was reminded of the matter he'd forgotten. The situation was, obviously, much worse than merely shrinking. He'd somehow become a child, not only physically, but, given his reaction to his father's lecture, emotionally as well. He pondered the subject, trying to remember anything from the day before which might explain it, only half paying attention to the rest of the table. Besides, the grown-ups, that is, his parents and aunt and uncle, were having some tedious discussion which he wasn't able to follow, probably since he'd missed the beginning of it. He racked his brain without success, unable to think of anything that could explain his strange situation. And, trapped at the breakfast table, it wasn't like he had a way to get more information. When Mike finished and wanted to leave, he had his chance to get away, at least. "Yes, you may both be excused." Nick got up eagerly, remembering only at the last moment that he had to land getting off the chair, and not merely stand up. He was halfway to the door, just behind Mike, when his mother cleared her throat. He and Mike both turned back to look at her. "Bring your plates to the sink, please." Both boys returned to the table and brought their plates over, earning an exaggerated thank you from her. Inside, Nick glowered at the condescension. Besides, he'd only forgotten because he was distracted by something more important. Before he could investigate, however, he received a less important distraction: "What do you want to play?" Not even "whether, just what," apparently, Mike considered it a given that the two of them would be playing together. And then, Nick had a thought to solve two problems at once. "Let's play secret agent. There are clues hidden all over this house, so we have to sneak around and find anything suspicious." Mike's eyes lit up. "Yeah." They started out in, what was now the kid's bedroom, since it was both the most natural place to be and the place most likely to have some clue as to what was going on. Mike found a number of clues, including the stuffed lion, whose name was apparently Kyle, and the clip-on fan by Mike's side of the bed, which Nick half-heartedly helped work into a rather lame spy story to keep Mike interested. Unfortunately, Nick's rather thorough search didn't reveal anything that would be out of place in a room being shared by 2 8-year-olds. And, intent on his search, Nick didn't notice the suspicious, thoughtful look Mike gave Nick's back partway through the game. The next room to be searched was Nick's parents', but before long, hearing footsteps coming down the hall, Mike declared, overacting more than a bit, that it must be one of the bad spies, and that they needed to hide. Annoyed, but not wanting Mike to lose interest, Nick joined Mike hiding under the bed. And when Mike continued whispering about the bad spy, and what he a vacation. A stirring on the other half of the bed woke Nick up, and he lay there for a moment, eyes closed, enjoying the motion of the bed as it rocked slightly with someone's sleeping breath. As he woke up, a question popped into his mind, who, exactly, was lying next to him? The day before was still a bit fuzzy, but he couldn't remember meeting a girl, let alone inviting one to spend the night with him. How could he have invited a girl to sleep with him here in the beach house, with his parents and aunt and uncle just down the hallway? Opening his eyes, he looked over with a bit of trepidation. It was his little cousin, Mike, lying on his stomach fast asleep. Lying far too away for this to be the cot in the room Nick had claimed. Looking around the room, this appeared to be one of the three main bedrooms, presumably the one Mike had been sleeping in. Nick sat up and looked around more carefully. There was plenty of light, thanks not only to the bits slipping past the edge of the window shades, but to the nightlight which still glowed across the room. Nick had, apparently, shared the queen-sized bed not only with Mike, but with the giraffe he recognized as Mike's personal companion and a lion which was less familiar. But why? He tried to remember the day before. It was easy enough to remember the long drive from home, in the back seat, headphones on, practically sulking about his parents' theft of a week of his precious summer vacation for a family trip to the middle of nowhere. He remembered gleefully claiming the little room at the end of the hallway, the one with the fold-out cot, gladly accepting the mediocre bed for a shred of privacy. He had, even, fantasized a bit about meeting a fellow college student, perhaps, like him, stranded here with family, and sneaking her in through the back door. The thought made Nick glance over at his companion. The boy was sprawled out in just his underwear, the lack of pajamas presumably a concession to the heat. Looking down, Nick wasn't surprised to see that he, too, had slept in just underwear. He was surprised that, instead of his usual boxers, he was wearing flyless blue striped briefs. Indeed, they appeared to be identical to the ones Mike was wearing. A bit embarrassed, not to mention confused, by the skimpy clothes, Nick decided to head over to his actual room to change. Trying not to wake Mike, he shifted carefully.